Hare Krishna, everyone. Dhanvat Pranam. I prepared just very simple slides, more for my own reference. So I'm talking about Niyamagraha. My references for these were Bhakti Loka book by Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur and Chaitanya Charan Prabhu's Nectar of Instruction series on the YouTube. So, in Bhakti Loka, the Niyamagraha is quite complicated discussion. So I will save that for the last. I will discuss what Chaitanya Charan Prabhu discussed in his series. I think that is more something we can associate and understand a little bit more in today's world. So let's see what that means. So Niyamagraha is a Sanskrit word which can be broken into two different ways. So based on the Sandhi Vichhed, it could either be Niyam plus Agraha or Niyama plus Agraha. So depending on where you break it, it will have two different meanings. So if you call it Niyam plus Agraha, so then it means, Niyam means rule, Agraha means to insist, like Agraha Karna, to insist on rules without understanding the principle. So to really follow the law to the last letter is basically Niyamagraha. Niyamagraha means to neglect the rules, to break or to whimsically just ignore the rules is another, if you break the word in a different place, then it becomes Niyama plus Agraha to neglect the rules. So what does it mean by breaking the rules or following the rules too rigidly? What are rules and what are principles? So rules and principles, we have to understand these two words very carefully, because this is something that is the key to the understanding Niyamagraha. So rules are, so you can compare it to like roads. And principles, you can compare it to, let's say, compass. So compass gives us the right direction. So let's say we have to go to north. The compass will tell you that if you point the compass, okay, this is where the north is. So we are trying to get to north. Now we'll find the road that will take us to north direction or to that particular direction. So rules are the roads that will take us to the right direction or the right principle. So the road is not as important. You can get to a particular direction through different roads. Now, there are rules set in scriptures or by our spiritual masters and by our previous acharyas and everybody. So we should try to follow the particular road that has been prescribed by them to follow that principle. Because typically that road or that rule will be the best way to get there. That rule will be the most favorable to achieve that principle. So ideally, we should try to follow that rule. So ideally, both rules and principles are important. We shouldn't think that, okay, rules are not important, I can break them. No, they are in an ideal situation, in an ideal world, both rules and principles are important. But rules can be dependent on the time, place, and circumstances, whereas principles do not change. Principles stay same. So the main thing to understand is that what is our principle? So that let's establish our principle. First and foremost, what is a principle and how do we follow various rules to get to that principle? So there is only one principle, which is remembering Krishna. And forgetting Krishna is not allowed. So remembering Krishna is the eternal duty, as you see in the shloka by Padma in Padma Puran. And actually, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur also quoted the shloka in Bhakti Lok, that remembering Krishna is the eternal duty. All other prescriptions mentioned in the Shastras have arisen from this main prescription. Forgetting Krishna is never allowed. So when we say rules, there are some do's and some don'ts. Rules means things that we should do, like a prescription, like a prescribed duty. That is called vidhis. Vidhi or do's is one thing, one part of the rules. And then there are some things that we should not do. Don't do are called nishedhas or prohibitions or restrictions. So what is our main vidhi or main rule that we have to follow is remembering Krishna. And what is the one don't is to not forget Krishna, that forgetting Krishna is not allowed. That is the main prohibition. So keeping this in mind, then we can decide our rules And again, we ideally try to follow the rules that are mentioned by our scriptures and masters. But what are the, I'll talk about various situations where sometimes we have to break the rule. So for example, again, taking going back to the analogy of road and compass, let's say your compass shows you a north direction and you start following a road to get there. But then the road was blocked. There was like a big a landslide or something on the road. It's blocked. You cannot go by that road to that particular direction. So what next? You're not able to clear that landslide. You're just one person. You're not able to clear it. So then in order to get to your destination, you may have to either find a different road. You may have to go through forest. You may have to do cross country, whatever. So you may have to do something else to get there because the road that you were following is blocked. Doesn't mean that you turn around and give up. Okay, I'm not gonna do this anymore because this road is blocked. So similarly, in order to achieve our right destination, our right principles, sometimes there will be roadblocks, meaning that we are not able to follow certain rules. Then we have to find a way to get around them. We should not be very rigid and say, no, my master said this, so I will not do otherwise. I will not take another road. I will take only this road. And if it's blocked, then I'm just going to sit and or just going to give up. So for example, Prabhupada prescribed that we should be chanting loudly. We should hear each and every syllable of the mantra. Now, somebody, let's say, has a throat problem. They are mute. They have a cancer of the throat, or for some reason, they cannot speak. So then doesn't mean that they give up chanting because Prabhupada said to chant loudly. They can still chant, but they will chant in their mind now. So again, the principle is to remember Krishna. So in achieving that, the big principle, this rule can be bent according to that person's current situation. So that is why rules can sometimes be dependent on a time, place, and circumstance. Like for example, when temples are built, there are many rules in how a temple should be built according to, let's say, Vastu Shastra, or how the deities should be facing towards east, so they are facing the sun. There should be tower on it. There should be like a gumbad or something on it. So all those rules are made so that the temple has the correct spiritual, auspicious ambience and atmosphere. So that is why those rules are made. Now, Prabhupada, he was very, he was not a stickler for rules. He was not very rigid. He was quite flexible. So for example, when he was in America, there was no way to establish temples in such a way where you can construct such temples according to proper rituals and rules and follow the exact dimensions and directions and everything. So, for example, he installed deities in the storefront, and that was a place where deities were set up. So it was convenient for most people to come and pay obeisances and to get prasadam. And this is how he was able to attract a lot of people. Now, there are people in India who condemned him for this, like brahmanas who condemned him including non-Indian, non-Brahminical people into the community of Brahmins and initiating them into Brahmana as Brahmanas, or setting up these temples that are not according to our Shastras. So he was condemned for these, but he was always stickler for principle. So the higher principle is to spread the Krishna's message. The higher principle is to remember Krishna at all times. So this is the way to do it, because Western countries, they are not, if you're spreading Krishna's message or setting up temples in Western countries, you don't have many resources. Then this is the way he found was most convenient. So sometimes people can complain about not following the rules strictly, but actually even in our Shastras, there are examples where sometimes, let me open this shloka. Actually, I will open from Vedabase so we can read. There is example of Bhishma Dev when he, in the first canto, chapter 9. Sorry, let me find it really quick. So this is 1.9.9.
We can't see it, Natasha.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm just trying to open it. I thought I had opened it already. So when Bhishma Dev was on his bed of arrows and everybody had come to pay respects to him, this is the shloka. Can you see it now?
Yes.
So Bhishma Pitama was not able to get up and pay respects to them. But in his own way, he paid respects. He paid mental obeisances to all the rishis and all the demigods that had collected around him. And this is the word that Prabhupada used, actually, that is used in Bhagavatam twice. Once in context of Bhishma Pitama, it's called Desh Kal Vibhagavit. Tan Samitan Mahabhagan Upalabhya Vasuttama Pujayam Asadharmagyo Desha Kala Vibhagavit. So Desha Kala Vibhagavit means one who knows adjustment of place and time. So according to the time and place, Desh is place and Kal is time. According to time and place, they could adjust their religious principles accordingly. So Bhishma Dev is described as Dharmagyo. Dharmagyo means somebody who has knowledge of the religious principles. So he knew the religious principles. He knows how to pay respects, but in his situation, he cannot. So it doesn't mean that he does not pay respects at all. He paid respects in his own way that was possible. So Bhishma Dev, who was the best among the eight Vasus, received and welcomed all the great and powerful rishis who were assembled there, for he knew perfectly all the religious principles according to time and place. And actually, if we read the purport, here Prabhupada talks about how things should be adjusted in discharging our duties towards Krishna and to preach the message of Krishna. So he says that, I'll just read one or two lines. There are different climates and situations in different parts of the world. And if one has to discharge his duties to preach the message of the Lord, he must be expert in adjusting things in terms of the time and place. So that's what Bhishma Pitama did. And then there is another shloka where the same word Desh Kal Vibhagavit is used, and that is in context of Dhruv Maharaj. So Dhruv Maharaj also, so first of all, Narad Muni gave Dhruv Maharaj this mantra. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So this is the 12 syllable mantra for worshipping Lord Krishna. And this was only given to Brahmins or people who are knowledgeable and austere. And Narad Muni gave this mantra to Dhruv Maharaj. And when you are uttering this mantra, there are certain rituals you have to follow. There is deity worship that is entailed. There is you have to offer fruits and flowers and all this. And Dhruv Maharaj was in forest, so he could not do all those things. Yet he was allowed by Narad Muni to chant that mantra. So you see the same word here, Desha Kal Vibhagavit. Again, according to the country or place and time, the one who knows the divisions, one who adjusts. So I'll just read the translation of this. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. This is a 12 syllable mantra for worshipping Lord Krishna. One should install the physical forms of the Lord, and with the chanting of the mantra, one should offer flowers and fruits and other varieties of foodstuffs exactly according to the rules and regulations prescribed by authorities. But this should be done in consideration of the place, time, and attendant conveniences and inconveniences. So ideally, all this paraphernalia is needed when you chant this mantra and you worship. And again, Prabhupada elaborates in the purport that how things sometimes have to be adjusted. So let me find the relevant part here. So this is the relevant part. The method of worship, chanting the mantra and preparing the forms of the Lord, is not stereotyped, nor is it exactly the same everywhere. It is specifically mentioned in this verse that one should take consideration of the time, place, and available conveniences. Our Krishna consciousness movement is going on throughout the entire world, and we also install deities in different centers. Sometimes our Indian friends, puffed up with concocted notions, criticize. This has not been done, that has not been done. But they forget the instruction of Narad Muni to one of the greatest Vaishnavas, Dhruv Maharaj. One has to consider the particular time, country, and conveniences. What is convenient in India may not be convenient in the Western countries. Those who are not actually in the line of Acharyas or who personally have no knowledge of how to act in the role of Acharya unnecessarily criticize the activities of ISKCON movement in countries outside of India. The fact is that such critics cannot do anything personally to spread Krishna consciousness. If someone does go and preach, taking all risks and allowing all considerations for time and place, it might be that there are changes in the manner of worship, but that is not at all faulty according to Shastra. And then he gives the example of Ramanuja Sampradaya, that conditioned souls or chandalas who are born in lower families lower than Shudra families can also be initiated according to circumstances. So just to give you an example from our Shastra, where it has been shown by some Vaishnavas how rules may have to be changed in following the big principle of Vaishnav Seva or serving Krishna. So then Chaitanya Charan Prabhu gave some more examples on how, for example, the one example was somebody asked him, can we underline, like, you know, how we underline books, can you underline on Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam? So one of the Brahmins was completely against that. He said, no, because every word is transcendental. Every word is divine. So by marking, are you saying that certain words are more important or more relevant than the others? No, everything is said by Krishna. So everything is very, very relevant and important. So, and this is Bhagavatam is worshipable. So you cannot desecrate it by marking or by you contaminating it by underlining and highlighting and all this. So, but that is, but you know, Prabhu said that is not a very rigid rule that one has to follow, because some people may not be able to read very effectively unless they mark on the book or they write in the margins or they highlight or something. They're able to understand better. They're able to go back and quickly read some things if they have marked. So imposing on others without understanding other people's situations or circumstances can be sometimes very discouraging. So in Krishna consciousness especially, we are trying not to impose on the rules very rigidly, because that can be very discouraging to people. Especially these days, you know, people are already very materially contaminated. And for them to follow very rigid rules, it may not be very, it's not encouraging. It may, we may come across as fanatics to them. So that is not recommended when spreading Krishna consciousness. I will go back to the slides just for a little bit. So another thing he mentioned was there is matter of principle and then there is matter of preference. So these things, like for example, marking and all these things, they are matter of preference. We should not condemn people for things like that. Can you see the screen?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay.
Go on. Yeah, Mataji, now I can.
So he said there are certain things that are matter of principle and certain things matter of preference. Matter of preference should not be absolute. If that becomes absolute, matter of preference is based on people's own situation, their cultural context, you know, where they are living, like time, place, circumstances, we always say. So that is matter of preference. Principle should remain the same, otherwise we are just fanatics. So for example, there are some standards for deity worship, but that can be variable with different countries. Some standards of deity, or even within different temples, within different ISKCON temples, sometimes the standard slightly changes based on which country they are and everything. And so nobody should condemn, you know, you visit another temple or another country and you say, oh, we do things like this, why do you do things like that, and start arguing about those things. He gave another example, like devotees were distributing chapatis to orphans. And they asked Prabhupada, how many chapatis per orphan do you think we should make or we should keep? So Prabhupada said, they're, you know, little kids, maybe they'll eat 3 chapatis per orphan. So why don't we make a budget or make a plan for 3 chapatis per orphan? So now if you say, if a kid is eating more, you say, no, Prabhupada said only 3 chapatis. You cannot have more. So that is being a fanatic, like trying to follow the word of your master to the last letter. And when he did not mean it in that, that was not the import of the instruction at all. Because, you know, again, some kids are more physically active, some are bigger built, whatever. So they may have more requirements, some may have less requirements. You cannot impose 3 chapatis on all the kids when someone might want 5. So that is, he gave another example of how things can be followed very rigidly without understanding the situation. And so he said, every tradition has a central core. That core should always be preserved, and then the periphery around it can change. Periphery is the presentation, basically. So presentation can be variable, periphery can be variable, but as long as our central principle of Krishna consciousness stays the same, like serving our masters, following the scriptures, deity worship, you know, following our festivals properly, all those are the central core. And in turn, all of those things basically help us to serve Krishna, help us to serve our master, help us to remember Krishna all the time. So that is the central core. And that should always stay the same. So Prabhupada actually was very good at deciding what is good for what place and time. He was very good at adapting. So we should know what to adopt and what to adapt. So things sometimes when you go to different countries or, you know, places, you have to adopt to different, you have to adopt different means of spreading Krishna consciousness, and you have to adapt to their different culture. And he was very good at that. Now, for example, he gave example of Bhagavad Gita. Let's say when Krishna gave the instructions of Bhagavad Gita to Arjun, he just started, you know, from the knowledge of soul and everything. But today, if we're giving the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita to somebody, we may have to backtrack even further and talk about how there is a God, actually. First of all, we have to tell the person that you need to start believing in a God, that there is an existence of a higher authority. So people even need to be prepped for listening to Bhagavad Gita. Why? Because the yuga has changed. Now it is Kali Yuga. Now the cultural context has changed. Now the contamination has happened a lot, that we cannot just say, oh, Krishna started talking from here, so I'm just going to start talking from here. But no, we have to prepare people because they're not even ready to listen to Bhagavad Gita. They don't even believe in the authority of a superior God. So again, standards have changed. Lifestyle has changed. Our values have changed. Cultural contexts are different. So the way we spread our Krishna consciousness has to be in such a way that it fits all those things. If we really insist on rules, then we will be losing a lot of potential, devotees or people that could actually become very big devotee Vaishnavas later on. So another example he gave was, for example, we pay Dandavat Pranam to our seniors, and you you bow down in front of seniors. But there are countries where slavery was very prominent. So in some countries, that kind of bowing down may remind them of the time of slavery. So it may not be very intelligent to bring that up as the first thing. So let them slowly understand the message of Krishna consciousness, understand the belief system, how spiritual masters are also servants of Krishna, how we serve them, and why do we pay obeisances to them. So maybe back it up with some knowledge before suddenly throwing at a person, okay, you need to just bow down. But so in that context where slavery was very predominant, those people may get offended and may never return. So then that is basically Niyamagraha. So there should be some thoughtfulness when we are talking to different types of people. So then going to the other understanding of this is the other Sandhi Vichhed, which was Niyama plus Agraha, meaning ignoring the rules or rejecting the rules whimsically. So basically thinking, this is not important. How is this relevant to Krishna consciousness? How is this helping me in serving Krishna? I can bend that rule. I can break that rule. So that is also Niyamagraha. So just whimsically, without any strong reason just not following certain rules. So example here he gave was, let's say dress of Vaishnava. So somebody might say, okay, even if I'm dressed in shorts or jeans or something, I can still chant. Why can't I serve Krishna? Like, how is that an impediment in bhakti, or how is that not allowing me to progress in my service or devotion? So yes, that's right. But initially, when our consciousness is so polluted, our externals do affect our internal consciousness. So the dress, for example, if you're wearing shorts or something that is for ladies, let's say something revealing that shows the body's contours, or then that makes you bodily conscious. So that increases the bodily consciousness. When we are trying to decrease the bodily consciousness and trying to increase the Krishna consciousness, so then that is not conducive very much to Krishna consciousness, because it affects our psychology. Similarly, let's say bad gestures can affect the psychology, right? If you're humbly bowing down, folding your hands in front of somebody, then you are in a servitude or subservient relationship to them. Whereas if you're somebody sitting in front of you and you put your feet on the table or something, then that means you are very friendly, or they are subservient to you. So your gestures, your posture also decides the your attitude towards other people, towards Vaishnavas. So dress also does that similarly. So initially we need a little bit of discipline. We need the rules, like following the regulative principles. You know, those are the basic rules that have been prescribed by Prabhupada and in our by our acharya. So those should be minimum followed. 16 rounds of chanting. Again, Prabhupada, some people say, oh, why shouldn't we chant all day? Yes, you can chant all day, but 16 rounds is minimum. So at least let's do that. And yes, if you can do more, that's fine. But there are minimum rules that if we try to follow, then we can maintain discipline, especially in the initial phase of our Krishna consciousness. So those rules, that much discipline is necessary to bring a little bit of detachment from material consciousness, from fruitive activities, basically detachment from from our surroundings, and more focused on inward things rather than outwards. So those rules do need to be followed for advancement for conditioned souls. So then he used the word strictness versus fanaticism. So strictly following the rules is good if you can, yes, but rigidly becoming very rigid that if this is not done, then I'm not doing bhakti. Like if the deity is not facing this way in the temple, then I'm not going to this temple, or I'm not praying here to that deity, something like that, then that is fanaticism. So strictness in following rules is good, discipline is good, but we have to just do everything in a balanced way. And keep ultimate purpose in mind, that ultimate purpose is to serve Krishna, and rest are all rules, and prescriptions and prohibitions are both just means to get there. And there are some are very good means that have been told to us by our masters, and we should try to follow those means, those rules in a proper way as we have been told. And some are mentioned in scriptures that may not be very feasible in all circumstances. So in keeping the ultimate goal in mind, those can be bent somewhat. So this is what I had from Chaitanya Charan's Charan Prabhu's lecture. I just wanted to quickly mention about what Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur said in Bhakti Lok, because that is a very, very different understanding of Niyamagraha. But I think it is also important to understand that particular definition. So the way he discussed this was Niyamagraha. So we understand Niyam is rules, and rules can be do's or don'ts, like Vidhis or Nishedhas. Vidhis is do's, and Nishedhas are don'ts. So prescription and prohibition, basically. So he said that for each level of human beings, there is certain prescriptions and prohibitions. Let's say when we are karmis, when we are completely given to fruitive activities, no devotional service, no bhakti in our life, not even aspiring for any knowledge, no detachment, no renunciation, nothing. We are just doing fruitive activities. Even those people should follow some prescriptions and prohibitions. And as you advance to the next level, so after karmis, the next level comes as karmkand, right? Where you are staying in your varnashram dharma, but you're following the rules of the Vedic scriptures. So you follow the rituals as mentioned in the Vedas. You worship demigods. So karmkand is basically the next level after karmis. So you have given up some illicit activities, but you're staying in the varnashram dharma and you are doing some more worship and rituals and more religious activities. So when you are in karmkand level, you will give up the prescriptions and prohibitions mentioned for the karmis. So there are prescriptions and prohibitions for each level. And as you advance to the next level, you should give up the ones for the lower level. If you keep following the ones for the lower, the rules for the lower level, then you will not be able to advance to the next level. So sticking to the rules mentioned for the lower level is called Niyamagraha in Bhakti Lok. So after Karmkand, the next level is Gyan, where a person starts detaching himself, starts getting situated in knowledge mode. After Gyan comes Gyan Khand, so he becomes a proper renunciate. And after Gyan Khand, Bhakti. And then Bhakti, we know there are 9 stages of Bhakti, starts with Shraddha. As soon as one has developed Shraddha, he can be situated in the devotional process or Bhakti. And then that is Bhakti, or 9 stages, is further divided into Sadhana Bhakti and Prema Bhakti. So once you reach the Bhav level, Bhav and Prema, if you remember, are the last 2 levels. And so that is the Prema Bhakti. So then for people that are in Prema Bhakti, the rules and regulations are very different from the ones that are in Sadhana Bhakti. The ones that are in Sadhana Bhakti, rules and regulations are different from those that are in Gyan Khand. Gyan Khand have different rules than Gyan. So in this way, the rules keep changing. And as you keep advancing, you should give up the prescriptions and prohibitions of the previous level and keep advancing. The person who does not follow the rules of their level, the level that they're on, and sticks to the previous level will fall down and will have durgati or degradation, regression. And if he keeps following them strictly, then he will be able to advance. And that is called advancement or sadgati or progression. So this is the shloka that he quoted. This is from Bhagavatam, where Krishna says to Uddhava, that these are 2 shlokas, 11.21.2 and 7. Steadiness in one's own position is declared to be actual piety. So if one can follow, so this basically means if one follows the rules and regulations of their own level, of their own position, of their own status or step, then that is the piety. Whereas deviation from one's position is considered impiety. In this way, the 2 are definitely ascertained. O saintly Uddhava, in order to restrict materialistic activities, I have established that which is proper and improper among all material things, including time, space, and all physical objects. So basically, Bhakti Lok describes that piety is to stay steady in one's position and follow one's prescribed duties. Impiety is to deviate from one's position. And remember these steps that I mentioned were for conditioned souls. Conditioned souls are the ones that are advancing through different levels: karm, karm khan, gyan, gyan khan, bhakti, all that. The eternal people that are in constitutional state or their eternal state, liberated souls, they have only one prescription, and that is prema for Krishna is their prescription, and prohibition is envy. So no envy and prema. So they have only that prescription. Other than that, if they want, they can follow the rules and regulations of a previous level if they want. But for eternal or liberated souls, there are not many rules and regulations prescribed. So then there is another shloka quoted. This is 11.18.28. A learned transcendentalist dedicated to the cultivation of knowledge and thus detached from external objects, or my devotee who is detached even from desire for liberation, both neglect those duties based on external rituals or paraphernalia. Thus, their conduct is beyond the range of rules and regulations. So this is for a proper devotee who it said that once you reach the stage of bhakti or jnana, you can leave the stage of karmakand basically. So external rituals or paraphernalia can be given up. So this was from advancement from karmakand to jnana or to bhakti. And this is from Hari Bhakti Vilas. And this is for a pure devotee. So this is advanced bhakti. This is after sadhana bhakti when somebody has reached the prem bhakti. When one becomes a pure devotee of the Lord, then devotion is spontaneously established in his heart. What then is the need to observe rituals that simply obstruct one's devotional service? And this is another one for pure devotees. Material piety and sin, which arise from good and evil of this world, cannot exist with my unalloyed devotees, who, being free from material hankering, maintain steady spiritual consciousness in all circumstances. Indeed, such devotees have achieved me, the Supreme Lord, who am beyond anything that can be conceived by material intelligence. So just wanted to share some of these shlokas that mention how the level of pure unalloyed devotees is completely different. They are beyond any rules and regulations. If they want, they can. It may seem that they're following some rules and regulations of jnanis or karmis or something like that, but they are beyond any rules and regulations. For them, the only rule is prem and the only prohibition is envy. This is another one that says the same thing. The devotees whose mind are fixed on chanting and remembering Krishna's glories in pure love have no taste for activities prescribed for lower stages. Although they are not attached or bound to follow the prescribed rules of the scriptures, they sometimes follow out of their own accord. This is nicely explained in the 8th verse of Upadeshamrita. So that is the nectar of instruction we are reading. These are the glories of the pure devotees. That is, their glories are not diminished by neglecting others' prescribed rules. So they do not need to follow others' prescribed rules. If they do follow somebody's prescribed rules, they can do that too, but they're not bound to follow those rules. So it was a little bit more complicated in Bhakti Lok. That's why I've started with Chaitanya Charan Prabhu's lecture. If somebody wants to read this, please, this is just from Bhakti Lok. But the ultimate import of the book was that observe the rules and regulations of the step you are on, and that is called Swadharm. And following those rules is described as your virtuous duty. And conditioned souls can make advancement when they try to follow those rules and regulations, and they can advance even from the most degraded state of life. And that is our prescribed duty, to perform the duties according to the particular position we are on, particular level we are on, and according to our own qualification. Like I said, the eternal rules are called, eternal rules are for liberated souls. They are called Nitya Niyam. Nitya Niyam is mentioned in Bhagavad Bhakti Rasa. That is the highest stage of Krishna Prema. And for them, the Krishna Prema is the only rule. And we follow various other rules based on our level. So that's all I had. I apologize if I made any mistakes or confuse everyone, but this is a little bit of a difficult topic to talk about. I understood the Chaitanya Charan Prabhu's lecture much more than I understood Bhakti Lok, but that's why I put some excerpts from the book here if you want to read. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol. Very nice.
Hare Krishna. Honestly. Very nice.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji.
Very
very nice.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji.